Hi, folks. So what is Lockwood? Who is Lockwood? Rob Lockwood. Rob Lockwood is a really good machinist, and he's also really, really good at Fusion and HSM CAM. And one of my things in life is I like being the second dumbest person in the room. And I kind of felt that way when I got to meet Rob Lockwood at IMTS with a bunch of other Fusion and HSM CAM folks. So I thought, hey, we've got this part. Came in from a customer and they said, how do I do the 3D tool pass? What are the right strategies? But CAM isn't a science. CAM is kind of an art, and there's some really good things that you can learn about it. So I thought, hey, I'm going to CAM this up. So I did, and we'll walk through it. And then I said, hey, Rob, can you go through it and fix my CAM? Do it even better. So he did, and then he sent his part back to me. So let's cut both the parts and let's look at the differences. I don't know what Rob did. I have his file, but I haven't really gone through it. Rob is posting his own video, and I don't know what he's gonna talk about, whether he's gonna correct me or whether he's just gonna kinda do roll his own strategy, but card to that video right here. Please watch it. And then we're gonna do a Fusion Friday as sort of a post-mortem, looking through mine, talking about some strategies, how I could have fixed it, the methodologies, and really cool, how to compare the two parts more directly so that you can understand those differences. Meanwhile, let's do a real quick walkthrough of my part, and then let's go make some chips, and let's see, does CAM make a difference? Welcome to another Wednesday Widget. So the John Saunders part, facing it off with a Superfly, poking a half inch hole through it, shear hogging out most of the rough material, 5/16 end mill to clean up the inside, the outside profile, let's see here, this straight walled section right here, a horizontal to clean up the floor right here. Then we get into an adaptive. I like to do adaptives with bullnose end mills or ballnose end mills that are at a little slower feed rate to kind of hog out. The adaptive looks at how much material is left. That way you don't all of a sudden dive a ball or bullnose end mill into a huge chunk of material. And after I've done that adaptive, we can cook with a scallop. So I did a scallop down here, and I did a scallop up here. Sear drilled, bored, it was out to size, chamfered them, and then finally I did a contour down here. So hopefully we're gonna learn from Rob's video, was scallop the right choice? Was contour the right choice? Are there better ways to contain these tool paths? I think I'm probably cutting air, but rather than dwell too much on that right now, but I will throw out, there's a video card here to Rob. He did a video on 3D tool path selection, the ultimate 3D tool path, really dialed in stuff. Again, thanks Rob for your content and for helping out with this video. Let's go make some chips. And here we come with the Superfly. We've actually learned we can go way faster. We're going about 50 inches a minute here, 2,500 RPMs. Half inch Swiss drill. My go-to recipe here has always been 1175 RPMs, 5.5 inches a minute. Shear hog, 4,000 RPMs, 10 thou per tooth, which is 40 inches a minute. Works great, really does. Some of the more details you can find again in the Fusion 360 file, which we offer for the page folks to support the channel on Patreon. But this is now a bull nose end mill. It's not something we've used a lot before, especially on the channel, but it's a 3/8 inch end mill, which instead of having a square corner, and instead of being a ball end mill, just has a big radius. In this case, it's about 60 thousandths of an inch, but they're great for doing this type of finishing work or surfacing work because a ball end mill, the problem is you lose surface footage right at the center, so I don't want to cut with that center. And we're done. Let's take a look at it. And we can see some faceting. It's a little bit tricky to see with the glare and the light, but you can see it in the corner of that
fill it. It's just, it's faceted. There's no other word for it. I'm otherwise not unhappy with it, but let's see if Lockwood's is better. I did cheat. Rob did not have the twist drill op in his part, but I don't like plunging solid end mills down into material, especially since I only own one of these end mills. So sorry, Rob, I cheated here. It doesn't really affect the task at hand, which is to see how much better Rob's part is going to turn out. You'll notice he did a lot more work with that one tool, and even here, we're cooking. 30 inches a minute, full depth of cut, 50 thou width of cut with a 3/8 inch tool. I would normally not push a tool that hard, but you can see we're making a great chip. Torbach has no problem handling it. The only thing I was concerned about was chip evacuation, especially on that center hole, which is one reason why I poked the drill through first, but really it worked great. So Rob, thank you for helping me push this a little harder than I otherwise would have. I'm not sure how well it comes up on camera right now, but there's definitely no faceting. You win this round so far, Lockwood. And sure enough, it does look so much better. Wow. It not only is there no faceting, but there's just something about the way the lines, the linking moves, and the blend of the tool paths between each other. Really impressed, Rob. Thank you. This is awesome. Let's deck off the backside. And you know what? I'm not going to do it a great way here. The problem is, well, we'll talk about it at the end of the video, but you start to reduce the amount of material that's left, and you can actually collapse the part on itself because of the jaw pressure. We are using the half-inch Maritool corncob roughing end mill, which is great here. I don't want to use the shear hog. It's too violent a rough of a tool on a part like this.
All right, Rob, you win this round. No, seriously, a much better part. So what happened? Click here for the Fusion Friday when we publish it on walking through the postmortem of why this turned out better. We decked off the backside as you saw. I didn't do it on this one because I really don't. This is such a thin part. As you clamp it, you're springing it up. It's just so likely that you're gonna rip the part out or you're gonna blow your tolerance because it's just not the right way to do it. So we can cover that, how to do that properly in a different Wednesday widget. Folks, I hope you enjoyed. I hope you learned. Take care. See you next Wednesday. And thanks again to Rob Lockwood for the collaboration.